Nearly 2 years ago, I set forth to build a pond for my parents. They loved the ones I had at my house and wanted to bring nature into their yard as well. Although a bit rushed, the process was straightforward and I made it happen. I'll recap on that briefly because the details are pertinent to what I'll do next. I had gravel, stones, and boulders delivered to their house, moved the landscape, and marked where I would put the elements, including the pond basin, waterfall, and overflow box. I dug within the marking to create a hole, which consisted of shelves to stack stones on. I excavated for the waterfalls as well. As I did all of this, I made sure to account for the overflow and spillway. I lined the basin with geotextile fabric and EPDM liner. Utilizing the shelves, I made sure to conceal all of this with boulders. I secured this portion of the liner to the overflow before repeating the process in the waterfall area. Joining the liners with seam tape and then rocking it all completed the task. Expanding foam allowed me to optimize flow within the waterfalls. I hid remaining areas of liner with gravel as my dad built up the berm with excess soil. Adding various plants brought the look full circle. The end result was decent and my parents enjoyed it. Other than some string algae, it was still looking good a few weeks later. However, my mom insisted on getting goldfish, so we added 5 comets. They were only about 3 inches long at the time and she was attached to them immediately. I knew it was only a matter of time before I'd have to expand the pond to accommodate them as full grown adults.
My mom was saying she's fine with it as it is, but I think I want to make it bigger, so maybe next year I'll expand it all the way out to here.
I wanted to do that last year actually, but the timing wasn't right, so here we are today. It's still early spring, so the pond doesn't look that great. They typically don't until the plants grow in. I also didn't do anything to prepare for the upcoming season because I knew what I'd do next. Regardless, the pond is doing well. The fish are thriving and have grown significantly. It's only a matter of time before they start breeding, so they're due for a bigger home. That will give them and a few additional friends a more stable environment as well because of more water volume. I'll also take a DIY budget approach with this build. I'll discuss the specifics of that near the end of the video. Anyway, to do this right, I'll dismantle the entire thing and start over. I netted all of the fish, took them to my house for safekeeping, and got to work. I removed some of the boulders and stacked them in a pile off to the side. Then I tore out the overflow box, pulled out the aquatic plants for later use, removed the rest of the boulders in the basin, and scooped out the gravel. This made it possible to remove the liner and geotextile, which revealed the pond as it originally was. The shape actually held up well, so all I had to do is expand it. I more or less wanted the same shape, so I just eyeballed it. My parents' yard is mostly clay, and although I removed some of it with a shovel, I'm really just setting the shape here. I went in with a pickaxe to break it up, which then made it easy to scoop out with a shovel. That more or less completed the first shelf, which as you can see is a good bit larger. The size increase really became apparent as I excavated the second shelf. I also had to account for filtration, which will consist of a trash can. I'll elaborate on it later, but in the meantime, I dug a hole to accommodate it. I checked the fit and went on to clean things up. I straightened out the edges, removed debris, and tamped everything down. As usual, I lined the hole with geotextile fabric. This is a preventative measure to protect the liner against sharp objects. I rolled out an EPDM liner over this, ensuring it conformed to the shape of the hole as I did. I could have put another layer of fabric over this for more protection, but I found it unnecessary for this build. Now for the fun part, the boulders. The bottom layer is the most important because it provides stability for everything else. So I selected ones with flat surfaces to rest on the bottom, doing my best to fit them together like a puzzle. I'm constantly checking them for stability as I do this. I left the waterfall intact earlier so I could pull boulders from it as I filled the basin. That way I'd only have to move them once and minimize the amount of work. I dropped the trash can into the hole before moving up to the next layer. This is also a good opportunity to point out the importance of having a range of stone sizes. Small ones like this and flat ones can greatly improve stability. I used 2 of the largest stones to frame in the trash can and continued until all of the sides were concealed. I collected golf ball sized stones and gravel, which I used to fill in the rest. The larger stones fill in the void spaces, which keeps the gravel situated. I was about done for the day, so I began filling the basin, spraying off debris as I did. Usually I wouldn't fill it this soon, but it was going to rain the following day. I didn't want water built up under the liner to disturb anything, and I wouldn't be returning for a week. Anyway, as it filled, I counted for spots where the liner was still visible. For best results, all of it should be hidden. I only filled it halfway, but that was good enough. Even now, at the end of day one, you can see a huge difference from the original build. Back the following week, and everything held up well. The first order of business was to build the berm around the basin. I rolled back the liner and used soil from the excavation to add height. I evened it out and tamped it down to ensure it stays. This made the pond even deeper, which meant I had to set more boulders along the top. I also removed excess liner, but only enough to work around the hole more easily. I ended up swapping a few of these stones with an oak branch that I sourced from a fallen tree on my property. Using woods adds a lot of interest, but only hardwoods like oak and cedar are suitable. I began filling once more because I was curious what the maximum depth of water was. It ended up being around 30 inches. As it filled, I increased the berm elsewhere to complete my work for day 2. The water appeared clear on day 3, but if you look closely, you can see dirt and sediment build up on everything. I dropped in a maintenance pump to clean things up, and because I have to get back into the basin momentarily. While it drained, I dismantled the rest of the waterfall. I pulled out the rocks, liner, and spillway. Personally, I think the waterfall was one of the worst features of the original pond. It was more or less just a continuous slope of rocks. I remember rushing that part, so I wanted to do it right this time around. I used a 20-gallon stock tub to create a reservoir at the top of the falls. The length was fine, so I simply expanded the original hole to accommodate the tub. It fit perfectly, so I went on to excavate the other area further. The trash can will tie into all of this through an intake bay, so I'll address that next. I drilled holes near the bottom to accommodate a perforated drain pipe. It's a snug fit, but that's ideal. I cut it down to smaller 12-inch segments on each side. Water will be pulled into the trash can through the perforated holes and the sides of the tubes. That said, I have it set up where they're pretty much directly against the sides of the hole. I also applied expanding foam between all of the cracks in the front. This will encourage water to flow over the boulders, creating a skimming effect in the process. On a side note, the regular expanding foam is fine for this. It's astronomically cheaper than quote-unquote pond foam and is readily available at most stores. The only con really is that it's harder to conceal because it's brightly colored. Anyway, I pressed gravel and stones into the foam while it was wet to conceal it for good. As you can see, you'd never know it was there if I didn't tell you. Then I put the trash can back into the hole and filled the void space around it. First with baseball-sized stones. As I did, I ensured it remained level, adjusting as needed. Next, I added a layer of smaller stones to ensure that the final layer of gravel will stay above these layers. I'll explain more about why I did this and how it works later. I finalized this area by putting boulders around the can and backfilling behind them for stability. Back up at the waterfalls, I pulled the basin liner over and covered the ground with geotextile. I folded the basin liner back and put another piece over top of this entire area, ensuring it overlaps. I cut off some of this one to get a parallel line. Then I pulled it back and thoroughly wiped down both surfaces to remove dirt and debris. This ensures that the seam tape adheres properly. I personally like to use double-sided seam tape for the interior seam only. I carefully apply it to the top piece, ensuring it remains flat. Then I remove the paper backing and press it into the other piece. On the outside, I use a single-sided seam tape. To cut costs, you could easily use the same tape as before and cover it with a strip of liner. However, I think doing it like this is a lot easier and doesn't cost much to do. With that addressed, I could finally add rocks. I built up the height of the rock face at the edge of the falls to start. I really wanted to make a unique feature here, and I was able to do that with flat stones I found in my yard. I got this one to fit perfectly on the left and leveled it out for optimal water flow. I placed a small boulder to its right, followed by another flat stone to create a split. Everything fit together perfectly, I just had to ensure that the flat pieces were level with one another. Then I framed the entire thing in on both sides. To ensure water flows over the rocks and not under, I foamed along the back. I covered it with gravel like before, but I also used moss. This doesn't harm it at all and keeps it stable until it clings to the surface on its own. I continued upwards, adding more layers as I did. This one included stones and driftwood, which I foamed in as well, again hiding it with gravel and moss. As I worked up to the top, I backfilled on the sides, which helped stabilize it all. Eventually, I made it up to the tub. Rather than build the waterfall around the spillway, in this case a stock tub, I built the spillway around the waterfall. I marked on the backside of the tub to perfectly align with the start of the waterfall. I cut along this marking with a utility blade. Getting it as straight as possible will help, but it's not make or break. I also drilled a hole in the top to account for pump tubing. As you can see, it lines up perfectly. I went on to backfill around it with gravel for stability. Now the reason the cut from earlier didn't need to be perfect is that I covered the gap with foam and stones to create a spillway. If it's close enough, it will work. I framed it in on the sides as well with stones. I fed a 1.5-inch tube through the hole, which I'll connect to the trash can. Additionally, I cut sections of corrugated pipe in half to create void space in the bottom of the tub. I included an upright piece alongside these for a clean out. I topped all of that with baseball sized stones. These will anchor the tub in place and also take part in filtration. That said, I didn't fill it completely because I want room for plants and additional filter media. I concealed the tubing with a trench that leads down to the trash can where I drilled an entrance. I installed the same EcoWave 2000 pump on this as before, but I'll likely swap it out with something stronger in the near future. While the pond was empty, I accounted for more open spots I didn't notice earlier. Another nice inclusion were these flat stones that I put on the bottom to create hides for the fish. Prior to filling it up for the last time, I thoroughly sprayed everything down as the maintenance pump removed the dirty water. Taking this extra step ensures the pond is as clean as possible from the start. Like I said, I didn't care for the waterfalls much on the previous build, so I was anxious to see how this would look. You can have a good idea from the design alone, but you never know for sure until it starts flowing. It looked incredible, but unfortunately, I made a major error. When I backfilled the stock tub, the liner receded, which caused a low point where water could leak out. I was able to lift it up to stop the leak, but I wouldn't fix it for real until the following day. The waterfall was still running like a champ, and even better now that the stones were fully saturated. The basin cleared up as well. However, I have to rectify my error. At first, I tried to pull out the gravel to give the liner some more room, but it just wasn't helping. So I shut off the pump and dismantled the entire stock tub. I really didn't want to do it, but it allowed me to remove the gravel, ensuring it all functions as intended. I backfilled behind the liner instead. I will say that this was probably all for the better though, because I got the spillway to line up even better than before. While the foam cured, I addressed an oversight. I didn't like how much space the stones around the trash can occupied. I replaced them with flat ones instead, which greatly increased the amount of space. I also concealed the front of it with a branch. Getting this line up properly was tough, but it's probably the easiest way that I could have hid everything from view. In the home stretch now, which means I can finally address the edging. If I could make a recommendation, let the pond run for a day or so while the edges are still rough. This makes it much easier to find and address potential leaks or low points, like the area at the top. If anything's going to leak, it's usually going to be something like that. Anyway, I cut off some of the excess, but not all of it. I left enough to hold back gravel or mulch. I fit another log across the stock pond that I'll use to build up the land. If you do something like this, it's best to put geotextile or foam along the cracks to minimize erosion. After doing so, I backfilled the area slightly so I could add more boulders. I used these to hide the stock tub and to protect the tubing from UV exposure. Then I backfilled it all completely. Even after all of that, it still doesn't look that great because the landscaping is off. Let's address that. To start, I hid the pump's cord in a trench along the edge of the pond so I don't forget where it is. I also put stones and gravel along the edges. I added various plants around the perimeter to naturalize the look. Even so, it's not going to look really good until all of it grows in. The trash can also needs protection from UV exposure. That's where the faux rock from last time came in. I got it to fit perfectly around the branches and it made everything look really seamless. On the fifth and final day, I brought everything full circle through the landscaping. I separated and cleaned off some Acorus grass to remove soil. I planted it within the waterfall and around the edges of the pond to soften the rocky edges. I love this plant because not only does it grow well in water, but it also has evergreen foliage. I edged around the landscape for a cleaner look and to help retain the mulch. I added a substantial layer which tied it all together. Finally, I poured a bag of lava rock into a mesh media bag and thoroughly rinsed it. I put this in the stock tub to provide more surface area for bacteria to colonize. And since it's in a bag, I can easily clean it down the road. The cleanout pipe I installed earlier will also aid in maintenance. I stirred up debris as I did all of that, so it's probably a good time to explain how the filter works. The pump draws water into this area, which is called an intake bay. There are plenty of ways to build intake bays. This is just how I did it. Anyway, as the water runs over the boulders in the front, it creates a skimming effect that pulls debris from the pond. That said, this functions best if the water leading into the intake is fairly shallow. That's why I stacked boulders in front of the can and foamed the seams. Since the intake bay is open, fish are able to freely swim in and out of it as they please. This is great because fish getting trapped in a skimmer box is a real issue and one that my parents dealt with previously. Luckily, none of the fish were hurt in the process. Anyway, once the debris is in the bay, it either remains floating or sinks into the gravel bed. The gravel polishes the water really well, which is why it appears so clear. It also provides a home for beneficial bacteria that will process said debris. Floating pieces have to be removed with a small net, which is why I wanted more space around the can. Another benefit to this is that the pump requires very minimal maintenance because it's protected by the gravel and the can. So, water gets pulled into the intake bay, down through the various grades of stone, and into the trash can via the pump. The pump then sends water up to the stock tub. It flows up through the stones, filter media, and eventually plants. I didn't add any yet because they're mostly out of season, but they'll thrive in a spot like this and help purify water. Once the tub fills with water, it spills out into the waterfall area, where it's stirred up and makes its way back into the basin. All of this creates a high oxygen environment, which is the optimal condition for bacteria and livestock. Also, on a side note, I chose the can I did because I like the lid and the crossbar in the middle. Anyway, all of this lends itself perfectly for crystal clear water in a way that's easily maintained. From the layout and feel of the basin, to the functionality and seamless appearance of the intake bay, to the intricate details of the waterfall, I couldn't be happier with how this all came together. It's honestly night and day from the previous pond if you ask me. My only complaint with it is that it needs more plants and has to grow in significantly, but we're still early in the season so I have to be patient. In line with that, I still have to add a lot of the aquatic plants that I removed from before, and the fish. I'll do that at a later time though. The fish have been indoors, eating and enjoying consistently warm temperatures. Since I've been feeding them, I don't want to rush and put them outside because they may get sick from the colder temperatures. Hopefully I can soon though. I personally think that tying in elements like the logs are what really made this build pop. I can't get enough of the waterfall either. The split turned out even better than I could have expected, and the driftwood makes the whole thing really interesting to watch. All in all, I think it looks awesome, and I can't wait to see how it progresses. And for what it's worth, all things considered, I was able to build it for a decent price. Now, to be clear, making a pond like this is not necessarily a cheap endeavor. However, there are plenty of ways to save money if you know what to do. Anyway, I'll show you how much I spent to build this specific pond as of spring 2023. If you're watching this later, it will likely be different. I'll also exclude the cost of the tolls because there's a lot of leeway there. Now then, I built this pond using 4 cans of expanding foam, a 20-gallon stock tub, 1.5-inch ID tubing, a bag of lava rocks, a mesh media bag, a trash can, perforated drain pipe, a hose clamp, an EcoWave 2000 waterfall pump, a faux stone cover, a 45mm 15x15 foot EPDM liner, which I should mention didn't have any reviews when I bought it, but now it has several bad reviews because apparently it's not flexible enough. I gotta say, I personally didn't have an issue with it, but I'll let you be the judge. A roll of geotextile fabric, a streamliner and fabric combo, single-sided seam tape, double-sided seam tape, stones, boulders, and gravel, which I bought back in 2021, various elements for landscaping such as plants and mulch, and free things from my property like a few flat stones and branches. All in, I was looking just shy of $2,000 at $1,972.76. Even so, there are plenty of ways I could have spent even less than that. For example, if I only used double-sided tape and extra liner as I explained before, I could have saved $25. I also could have concealed the trash can completely or used something else to create the vault to exclude the faux rock altogether. There are plenty of other components that you could find cheaper as well, like the pump for example. What I personally wouldn't recommend doing though is buying a thinner liner. Sure, it costs less up front, but there are certain things that you're better off just spending more money on. Finding plants on clearance is also a good move. Most big box stores will mark them down once they're out of bloom. Just get some perennials and they'll come back next year looking better than ever. I do this a lot to landscape on a budget. Keep in mind that this is an 11 by 9 foot pond, so going smaller is always an option.